like most musicians, I've had my fair share of day jobs. Back in 2010, I did 6 months training at a culinary school and then went on to work at a French bistro. Nothing taught me about the importance of preparation more than my time in a professional kitchen. Preparation is key in any kind of production environment, and in a kitchen, you're churning out product on deadline. Elements of a meal are pre-cooked and ready to be finished at service. All your tools are within easy reach. There are systems in place to make production as efficient and streamlined as possible. I believe in creating an organized system for the process of music production, and this begins with templates. I've created a familiar working environment within Logic Pro, with all my favorite plugin instruments in place, and a system of channel routing which allows me a great deal of power and flexibility as I compose, mix, and finalize my tracks. It may seem quite complicated at first, but you'll soon see that it can be as simple or as complex as you need it to be. My system is constantly undergoing revision, and I hope it inspires you to create your own production system and refine it to suit your own style and needs. I'm going to demonstrate the functionality of this system using a real-world scenario, and then I'm going to show you how to build one from scratch in both Logic Pro and Ableton Live. So, welcome to my most recent Logic Pro 10 template. It comes preloaded with all my favorite plugin instruments, as well as channels which allow control and audio routing for two hardware synthesizers. In addition to Logic's own instrument and audio channels, I also have the ability to route audio into Logic from Ableton Live. You'll notice that some of these channels have a little disclosure triangle next to them. These are track stacks and act as a folder for multiple audio and MIDI channels. Let's have a closer look at this Native Instruments Kontakt track stack. Opening up the track stack, we can see I have 4 MIDI control channels in place, and 8 audio return tracks for Kontakt to route its audio to. Rather than running multiple instances of the Kontakt plugin, I load one in multi-channel output mode, which allows me to communicate with the plugin along multiple MIDI channels, and route the audio of different sampler instruments into discrete channels. So as we can see here, this particular instrument has been loaded as multi-output mode. This makes for a more graceful project with minimal strain on the CPU. I have a similar setup going on for Machine and my Axis Virus. I think of all of these channels as the canvas. All of these channels generate sound in some way, and is really where the writing happens. Things can get a bit messy in the canvas area, so I need an ordered system to organize the signal flow of the audio from these generators, i.e. the instruments and audio channels which create sounds in your arrangement. This is what the mixer track stack is for, so let's look inside the mixer track stack. I'm just going to zoom out vertically so we can see all of the channels in the track stack, because there are quite a few. I use an organizational system based on the concept of 4-bus submixing. What this means is that ultimately all sounds in my arrangement are categorized as drums, bass, melodic, or atmospheric. I use a color coding system, so green for drums, blue for bass, purple for melodic, and yellow for atmospheric. This allows me to easily identify channels at a glance. These channels with the red mix icon, as well as the mix bus, denote that these channels are the highest in the hierarchy of the signal chain. In other words, they are the 4 main submix groups: drums, bass, melodic, atmospheric, and the final mix bus. All of my drum sounds will ultimately be routed into the drums channel, which then feeds to the mix bus. These D1 through D10 channels are the sub-submix channels, which is where I compartmentalize different elements of my drums before feeding them to the drum submix. So, for example, any sounds which make up the kick drum, bearing in mind that there may be multiple layers coming from different instruments or audio channels, will end up in this channel, currently labeled D1. I can simply rename this channel to Kick, and then, selecting another channel in the arrangement, such as one of my machine outputs, I can route the audio of that channel out into the channel I just renamed Kick. I'll demonstrate this in a moment. Now I will have easy control over that sound as I mix it with other elements in the song. The next channels can be used for other elements of the drums, such as snare, hats, percussive sounds, crashes, whatever you want. The audio for these channels ultimately feeds into the drum submix channel. Let's demonstrate using Native Instruments Machine. I'm going to load a kit, any kit will do. I'm going to quickly create a pattern, route the audio for different sounds to machine's discrete virtual outputs, and then route the audio into the appropriate mixer channels. Go over to machine and open the plugin so you can see what I'm doing. I will be interacting with machine using the physical controller, but as I do so, machine will update. Okay, so we've loaded a nice little pattern here, actually. It sounds pretty good. Kind of funky. I like it. So it'll be fun to work with for a bit. So I'm selecting the first kick drum. And what I want to do is basically route the output of this kick to a discrete virtual output. So I can change that either through the plugin this way. As you can see now, the M2 channel is lit up to show that it's receiving audio. I've selected the other kick there on sound 5, and using the knob on the machine controller, I've set the output. So I'm basically going through the entire kit, and I'm choosing different sounds, and I'm compartmentalizing them into different tracks. So, you know, the snare sound went into M3. This kind of shaker thing is probably going to go into M4. It's ended up in M3. Should have been M4, but never mind. This hi-hat is going into M4. This kind of sounds like a finger click, so that'll be a snare sound on M3. That's a hi-hat, M4. And now I'm just going to rename them. Kick, snare, hats. And now I can solo each channel, and I can just hear those elements from the machine plugin. Hit K to turn the metronome off. Here we can hear the hats. So it's just very useful to be able to do this. Just make the mixer window a bit taller. The next thing to do is to route the output of these channels into their respective mixer channels. So for kick, that's bus 1. It's already labeled, as you can see, next to the bus number entries. The name of the track that we gave them is there already, hopefully. So I'm just routing the output of these different channels into the mixer sub-submix channels, as I call them. So M5 doesn't even have anything yet, but let's have some percussive sounds for a bit more separation. So this is a kind of a weird garagey sound. That's a percussive sound, so I'm routing that to external 5 output. And you can see changing the name there to percussive, just perk. And any other sounds here? Just kind of looking through, seeing what we've got. Don't have time to root every different sound to a distinctive output, but this will do. So this one also routed to perk channel in the mixer. So closing the machine track stack. And actually, I think maybe we want some kind of a bass sound. So let's just keep it simple and go to the ESM. And I'm going to play in some kind of little bass line, something simple. Should probably work for now. So I'm going to hit the R key soon, put it into record mode, hit R again to take it out of record mode. We're still looping around. Hit the T key for my toolbar and 5 to get the scissors, and then I can just delete the unnecessary passage of the audio region. Hit the L key to loop it. Select all the notes inside, hit Q to quantize. Just tightening things up. I'm turning the cutoff filter down on the ESM just to make it really, really, really low sub bass sound. So that seems to be sitting quite nicely with the drum pattern. That'll do for now. So now I route the output of the ESM to B1, my first bus for the bass sounds. So B1, I'm just going to double click it, rename it to sub. And maybe we need some kind of upper melody. So let's open Absinthe and get some kind of a electric piano kind of sound. So just under the browser tab, piano/keys, we're gonna go electric piano, synthetic, and then corridor junk piano. Let's see what that sounds like. So playing a funky little melody there. Just something simple. Shows that'll work. The R key. The R key again. Select. Hit the L key to make the region loop. Command A and then Q to select all and then quant size. Extending the region length so that we have a bit of a rest. A bit of silence. We're gonna add some delay to that in a bit. Routing the output of the absinthe to another bus, this time bus 21, which is melody 1. Double click on melody 1, rename it to keys. So what else can we do? What else can we do? How's about some kind of atmospheric sound? A reversey sound, maybe some kind of a whoosh. So I'm browsing my sample library, going to the atmosphere folder, and gunshots, explosions, and FX might have something cool. So that's very loud. Some of these sounds might sound good. Which one? That. Okay, that one. So I'm just gonna add this into my audio bin. Zoom in here and open up one of the audio channels and just drag it into audio one. And you see it actually already names the track for us, which is convenient. Functions and then reverse. My favorite thing to do to audio. So now it just plays backwards and I'm just gonna slice off the end of it. So it just looks like a reverse cymbal kind of sound. And that's just gonna add a nice bit of anticipation at the end of the 4-bar phrase. It's probably gonna be a little too loud, but never mind. That's cool. Again, routing the output of the sound to one of the atmosphere buses, A1. Scroll up, double click, call it whoosh. So, I've got a few elements here to play with. Hit the X key to open up the mixer. Hit the B key to close the bin. So what are we gonna do here? I think basically we're ready to hide the unnecessary bus channels. I'm just gonna leave that one drum bus there for something else. We're gonna hide all the other bass buses that we don't need. I'm gonna hit the X key to hide the mixer while I do this. Hide the remaining melodic buses, don't need them. Hide the remaining atmosphere buses, don't need them. Hit the H key again. And now only the tracks that are remaining actually show up in the mixer. So we've got an overview of our whole track right here. So this is quite powerful. It allows us to do a whole bunch of things quickly and easily. I'm actually just gonna make another melodic bus channel available to do some effecting. So I'm gonna call this Keys FX. And I'm gonna set up a bus send to that channel, Keys FX bus 22. And now I'm gonna add a delay, I think. I'm not sure what I'm gonna add. Reverb. Yeah, I'm gonna go for delay. Good old tape delay, old standby. Always sounds good. So just tweaking some of the settings here. Turn the feedback up a bit. Of course, if the tape delay feedback is over 55, it actually starts getting louder as time goes by. It's an interesting effect. I'm just getting something I like here. Cutting some of the low end out of the delay. And then just adjusting the balance. Now I notice here actually that I put the tape delay on the wrong channel. I should have put it on the Keys FX channel. So I'm holding the command key and clicking and dragging to move the tape delay over. And now I've set the send from the Keys channel to the Keys FX channel. And on the Keys channel itself, I'm just gonna put a bit of reverb just to give it a sense of space. Choosing whatever quickly comes to mind here. I like small rooms generally. Turn up the reverb mix so it's quite wet, quite spacious. Tweak the delay settings a bit more, make it more wet, less dry. So, beginning to get a nice balance of different sounds. Compressing those kind of delaying effects against the kick drum is always useful, and that's why this system is so great, because I know that my kick drum is always on bus one. So I select bus one as the sidechain input, and then I adjust my settings on my compressor accordingly to make the sounds in the mix kind of pump against the kick drum. It's a very standard practice in house and techno. So this is me just adjusting various settings to get the kind of feel that I'm looking for, quite drastic compression against the kick drum. One thing I'm noticing about the kick is that it's really, it doesn't have a lot of definition. So I'm gonna use one of my favorites, Native Instruments Supercharger GT, and just basically crank it up a bit, hit the punch preset, add some character, add some saturation. So it's got a bit more balls now. Another problem I noticed is that it has a very long decay. It's sitting in the mix for a very long time, so I think I'd like to do something about that as well. So holding command and click dragging, I move the supercharger down one slot and I open up a dynamics noise gate. And this just allows me to cut off the decay of the sound and make it short. So it's much tighter now. I prefer this. So I can sculpt the envelope time of the kick drum by adjusting these parameters here. So that to me is better. Now I solo that channel so I can just hear how it's doing on its own and then bring other sounds up to meet it, to balance with the kick. Got an EQ on the snare here. I can adjust that a bit, bringing it down to about 1K and boost. Just options, lots of options to try different things with EQing and compression and effects. Just a very powerful sequence of routing options. So the drums effects channel I just created, I'm gonna add a space designer to that too. Always like to have a bit of reverb on drums. Go to small spaces, rooms, and just choose, I don't know, drum booth 2, why not? Then all of these channels, I want to send a little bit to the drums effects bus. So I've selected them all, and then I'm choosing the drums effects bus 6 as my destination for that send. And you turn one up and they all turn up because they're all selected. Bring the dry mix down, fully wet. Now you can hear the sound of the room there. And now I can adjust, send a bit more. So another thing that's quite useful to do is to listen to how certain elements balance against each other. For example, the kick and the bass is always a very important relationship to be aware of. So I've soloed the kick and the bass, and now we can think about things we want to do. And a classic thing to do, of course, is to compress your bass against your kick drum so that when the kick drum hits, the bass ducks out of the way. And then when the kick drum isn't in the mix, the bass rises back up to fill the low frequencies of your mix. So that's what I'm doing right here. I've set my sidechain input, bus one, which is the kick, and I'm adjusting my compression settings to make the bass pump back up around the kick drum. And then I just balance. I use my judgment, I use my ears, and I balance. Bring the other elements of the drum kit back in. Now I'm adjusting different send levels to the drums effects channel. And I bring other sounds back in. Holding the option key and clicking on one of the solo tracks will automatically unclick all solo tracks, which is also a very useful function. So, as I mentioned earlier, I set up tracks that will receive audio from Ableton Live. This is called rewiring, and it's something I do on pretty much all of my productions. So let's go over to Ableton, and I have this break ready to go. I checked it out earlier. I know it's going to work. So I'm choosing the rewire output of this channel to be on bus 3 and 4. And when I hit play on that, you'll see that the audio is coming back into Logic on the Live 2 channel, which has its input set as bus 3 and 4 from Ableton Live. So now I'm just renaming this track, calling it Break, and setting the output appropriately to bus 5, which I set up earlier called Break. So again, more compartmentalization of sounds, rewiring, this time rewiring audio from Ableton Live into Logic. And now I can adjust the amount of send to the reverb. So in this case, I don't want any. Bring all the drums back in. Hopefully you can see that this is really just the tip of the iceberg as to what's possible. The whole system is very expandable and very versatile, and it can be as powerful as you need it to be. So obviously when you get deeper into a production, you've got a lot more different sounds going on. You just have so many more routing possibilities, sidechain compression possibilities. Just generally useful to be able to mute and solo channels so that you have a good ear for what exists in your composition. What EQ or mixing decisions you might need to make between certain elements. Very useful for identifying if there are problem frequencies with particular sounds. Only when certain sounds are solo do you really get a full appreciation for the entire audio content of that sound, and you can decide which frequencies you want to get rid of to create space in your mix.